Really a pleasure to meet you and to have you come in, because from you, the first person experience with what you're dealing with on a daily basis, I would imagine. Now, you work in the South Riverdale Community Health Center, so right, as I said, on the front lines. Mm-hmm. What are you seeing today when it comes to fentanyl?
Well, we're already seeing fentanyl here, so it's already here in our communities, and it has been for a number of years. And we've seen a lot of people die of overdose. In the last years, we've seen an increase of overdose. So we've seen a 327% increase of overdose deaths in Canada since 2008. And in this community alone that I work in, we've seen an increase in deaths in the last year. And it's the most deaths that I've experienced as a frontline worker.
Ever. And you were telling me in the commercial break, you've been in this business 12 years.
So as far as
a threat, how does fentanyl rate overall as far as the threat as you perceive it?
Well, I think, like, I'm not sure if it's completely just fentanyl or if it's like we have to look at all of the issues that are affecting people. So I think it's important to look at this intersectionally as well. And, you know, we can teach people how to use it safely, which is, you know, what we do in harm reduction, which is what's been going on in the community that I work in, because it's here. The changing drug market is happening. It's going to continue to happen. So fentanyl has already arrived, and we need to be on top of knowing how many people are dying and how do we actually reach those folks who are overdosing or who are vulnerable to overdose. And that's what we do well in harm reduction. We actually connect with drug users where they are at, and that's important so that we can give people education of how to prevent overdose, how to, you know about it. And so we know and we get a handle on who is dying in our communities.
Okay, stop there for a second. I want to come back when you keep saying it's here already.
Vancouver,
this whole meeting today took place because Vancouver's mayor and Toronto's mayor were talking, and Vancouver's mayor was saying, Toronto, get ready. You're saying it's here already.
That's right.
So we've got to face it. But again, just give me a little bit more of a picture. In terms of your day-to-day, are you coming into contact on a daily basis in Toronto, in your particular center, with people who are using fentanyl?
I mean, there are people that are using heroin that they know is cut with fentanyl. There are people who are using fentanyl that they have bought off the street. There are people who use fentanyl already. Yes, we are definitely seeing that.
And your numbers have increased significantly?
Yeah, and we don't know if it's all related to fentanyl overdose. I mean, people already have a lot of vulnerabilities when they're street involved, when they're on the streets, when they're homeless. And we do have a high population of homeless people in Toronto, just like Vancouver. So some of the issues that Vancouver is experiencing have also to do with the fact that people are homeless and that they're much more vulnerable to overdose as well.
What about people who are dying? Have you personally dealt with people who have died as a result of fentanyl?
I lost a friend last year who died of an overdose to fentanyl. I mean, it was heroin laced with fentanyl. And there are people that I have worked with and who have been clients of mine who have died from what we presume to be fentanyl overdose. The problem is we don't always know what people die of. We don't get access to the toxicology reports. Sometimes that information goes to people's next of kin, so it doesn't come to us and our organizations to know exactly how people died. We don't have access to the coroner's report sometimes. So,
but it's part of your reality.
But it is part of the reality that I work in, yes.
So I'm wondering, the voices that we're getting from BC notably, but across the country, the urgency of getting a handle on this, because it is so potent, because it is so dangerous. So are you sharing that urgency that we've really got to move to get this under control?
I think that the urgency has been here for a number of years. So we knew this was going to happen once OxyContin was taken off the market. We kept saying in the harm reduction field that we're going to see an increase of deaths. And this is what we're seeing. We have seen an increase of deaths. So here in Ontario, it's 674 people died in 2014. That's one death every 13 hours. Mm-hmm. If that's not a crisis, I don't know what is. You know, we've had 38 pedestrians killed in 2015 here in Toronto, and we see that as a crisis. If 10 people were poisoned across this country in food poisoning outbreak, we'd see that as a crisis. We'd want to act. Thousands of people have died in Canada. Like I said before, 327% increase since 2008. That's a crisis. And we know what to do, and we know how to act, and we know how to be prepared. We did during the AIDS crisis in the 80s. We saw thousands of people die before we acted. And so it's important now that we work all together to address this crisis.
So as you go into this gathering of people who will be around the table, police and policymakers and people like yourself working with people on the street, you say harm reduction is key. We know what to do? What will be your message in terms of what has to be done to get ahead of this growing crisis?
I think we need to know what is really happening, and I think we're, you know, harm reduction is distributed out throughout the city. We have needle distribution programs all over the city, and I think we're key places for having a handle and understanding of the drug culture and what's happening, and I think that's super essential. And it's also important to be at the table with paramedics and hospital staff and police and public health officials so that we can all talk together and be able to work together on this crisis and, you know, come up with an action plan, but also have, you know, real evidence-based facts about what is really happening, where it's happening, and where we can act quickly. You know, we do have access to some really good things already. So we have naloxone distribution in this city. We need to make sure that's low barrier. Naloxone helps to reverse an opiate overdose. It's an antidote. We need to make sure that all people who use drugs, who are using opiates, or who are friends and family members of those folks can also have access to that in the lowest barrier possible way. We also want to have supervised injection services in this city, so those will also be key in addressing this crisis. They are really essential services that
need
to be
extended. And the federal government trying to renew the remove those barriers to get more opened up, but of course there's still a wait, isn't
there? We need those, and we know they're essential.
You know what? You're going to have a very important voice at this table today. I hope they're listening closely. You deal
Thank
with
you.
Us on a